If you think corporations bought free speech before, now that they're human, they'll buy even more. Yeah, their money has free speech.
Welcome to the Alliance for Democracy's The Populist Dialogues, our bi-weekly public cable access program designed to further the Alliance's mission to establish true democracy. I'm your host, David Delk. Our guest today is Colby Clipston. Colby is the Oregon State Director of Wolf-PAC. Wolf-PAC says that, quote, "We must reverse Citizens United, restore our democracy, and save the Republic. Join the fight for free and fair elections in America." So, welcome to the program.
Thank you. Good to be here.
Good to have you here. So, talk about Wolf-PAC. What was Wolf-PAC?
Well, Wolf-PAC was first made by a man named Cenk Uygur. He's host of the online news show, The Young Turks. And he's been with that show, doing that show in different forms, on the radio. He was on MSNBC for a little while, on Current TV before Current ended up folding. And he was inspired to form Wolf-PAC because over his years in the news and covering all the stories, he picked up on a current that if you just figure out which side has more funding and more money backing it, more inherently less power backing it, that side always wins. And he was getting kind of tired of just covering news stories and saying, hey, look, I have a crystal ball where I can figure out who has more money and tell you which side's going to win in advance. Mm-hmm. And as somebody who's really proud to be an American, he really wants us to have a democracy where it's about ideas and voter participation, not about money. So he decided to form Wolf-PAC because we want to restore that democracy to its once shining form where the people actually had a say and were the deciding factor, not money.
Uh-huh. Okay. And it's a membership organization, grassroots organization. What is it?
Yeah, we're a very grassroots organization. I'm the state director for Oregon, and I'm a volunteer. I'm not paid. We have probably around 3 or 4 people in the whole group are paid right now because we want to
nationwide.
Yeah.
Right.
Uh-huh. We want to make sure that we are people who aren't, though we're using, we are a super PAC ourselves. We want to make sure we don't fall into the same traps of other super PACs. We want to make sure we remain of and by the people of our group. And we very much want this to be volunteers who come on, can just call their state representative, their state senator, and have a dialogue with them and try and schedule an in-person meeting with them to get our resolution proposed in that state. And that's the functioning team we have. That's what I do. That's what other state leaders do. And that's what other volunteers in other successful states like California and Vermont have done. And that's our model for success. So we don't really want to change that.
Uh-huh. Okay. And so you just told me you're 21 years old.
Yes.
Which I applaud you for being this actively involved in something at your age, because I know a lot of people are not. At my age, a lot of people are not. So how did you get involved with this? What attracted you to this particular issue?
Well, you know, I've been politically active since I really figured out I had a passion for politics. In high school, I started to get introduced to just politics through some of my history classes and government classes. And I realized this is kind of an important thing, you know. So I started to pay attention to the news. I quickly realized that mainstream news doesn't really necessarily cover a lot of the important issues, or when they do, they cover them in certain ways through particular lenses.
Yeah, it seems like they mostly try to avoid any major issues.
Yeah.
Or any issue that is actually of importance.
Yes. Right. Yes. And the really substantive issues you won't see covered fully in the general news media. So I started to look to alternative news media, and that's when I stumbled upon the Young Turks. They're the largest online news show in the world at this point, so it wasn't really hard to find them. Uh-huh. I found them on YouTube, and from there out, I started to figure out more independent media sources, and that got me inherently plugged in with activism, because a lot of them try and make a special effort to mobilize their listeners to be politically active. And I've done some work with Move On in the past. When I moved out to Eugene, that's when the whole Occupy movement started going up. So when I was in university, I had a lot of work to do there as well. Wow. And since I've been involved with a lot of those movements. While they've had different focal points, there's one current that kept coming up when I was talking with people and holding protests or talking to people who I met at other protests. And the one vein that we all seem to have in common is that we feel like we're no longer represented, that there's some sort of problem systemically with what we have in this country. And if that's what we all agree on, and it's a systemic issue, it will affect all other issues. And we can't really get, for example, if you're on the left and you think, I want to prevent our planet from, say, boiling over.
Yeah.
Do you really think that, as somebody on the left, you can prevent us when we still give oil subsidies to the richest companies in the world? If we don't even have the political will to take away their subsidies, there's no way we can actually make real meaningful movement to going away from their entire energy source. That's their whole business model. We can't even stop giving them subsidies. Mm-hmm. So if you really care about that issue, it's not that this issue is more important, but this is the first issue. We
this
have
is
to
the
solve
bedrock.
This. Exactly. Uh-huh. If we can't hit the root problem that is the roadblock of all the other issues, we can only make so much progress on the other issues. And I want all the issues to be heard and solved. I don't want any one issue to be favored over the other. Mm-hmm. And I think right and left, when you talk to people, they all have, like, whatever their ideology is, they all have real meaningful substantive issues with a lot of the different things. And I want all those problems to be heard and addressed. And we're not going to have that if only the moneyed interests are what's heard, if only the moneyed problems are the ones that are addressed. So that's why I'm here, because I want that system to be changed back to what it was, where the constituents and the voters were the ones who were listened to.
Okay, right, yeah. So I think that you would agree with the motto of the Alliance for Democracy, which is the issue is not the issues, the issue is the system.
Yes.
Right. And the system is the system of political bribery.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so what does Wolf-PAC specific, having identified what the bedrock issue is, what does Wolf-PAC suggest that we do with it?
Well, you know, I mean, we wanted to fix, I mean, if the problem is money in politics and the corruption that that causes, we need to obviously change that system. But with the ruling of Citizens United, it's that system has now been encoded into our laws at a Supreme Court level. So the easiest way would be if the Supreme Court simply changed their mind and undid that ruling. But with the recent ruling
with McCutcheon, they're obviously not going in that direction.
Yeah, it seems like any hope of that isn't really...
Yeah, right. Yeah, if you had that hope, you're very naive.
Yeah.
Right, okay.
Unfortunately so. So, I mean, that option's kind of ruled out. So what can we do if we have to go above a Supreme Court ruling? Well, the only thing that's above the Supreme Court is the Constitution. So we're talking about getting an amendment proposed. Now, the traditional way amendments are proposed are 2/3 of both houses at the federal level pass an amendment, and then it gets ratified by 3/4 of the states. But when you look at the federal level, they tried to pass the Disclose Act, which was a very soft, easy bill about campaign finance reform that said, essentially, just tell us who's bribing you.
Yeah. And then that came as a result or a reaction to the Citizens United decision.
Exactly, yeah.
Right. So if that had passed, it still wouldn't have undone Citizens United or any of the other decisions.
But it would have shown that that was a possible route to take action through. But even so, even that, like you said, that didn't address the root of the problem and is a very simple thing just about disclosure, couldn't get passed.
Mm-hmm.
So any hope we had of going through the federal government as well also seems kind of naive at this point, and we can't really, at least unreliable. Mm-hmm. So that leaves us with literally only one option. If we need an amendment, but we can't go through the federal government, there's an alternate way in the Constitution to propose amendments, and that's to go for an Article 5 convention of the states. An Article 5 convention differs from a constitutional convention in that constitutional conventions have extra powers of, like, redrafting certain sections of the Constitution, everything like that, and we don't want to open the door for that.
Uh-huh.
And there are two types of Article 5 conventions. You can have a limited Article 5 convention or an open Article 5 convention. An open Article 5 convention could see anything from pro-life amendment to an amendment about how we should, what energy sources we should use, to an amendment about this. And we want to call for a limited convention, just limited to the topic of the Citizens United ruling general campaign finance reform, because we don't want this to become about other issues. Because in our country, there's only really one issue that we all agree on, and that's campaign finance reform and making sure that we actually have a system that represents the people. So what we're doing is we've got groups in all the states right now that are working to get the state legislatures to propose resolutions that would officially call for this Article 5 convention on the issue of Citizens United and campaign finance reform. Once we reach the two-thirds threshold to get that called, two-thirds of the state's state legislators have to call for that, there will be a convention to actually draft the legal language of the amendment or amendments to be proposed. And those amendments will, again, go back to the states for the normal three-quarters ratification process.
The Constitution says that the states would apply for a convention. That would imply to me that Congress would have the ability to not grant the application. Is that a possibility?
Well, we don't, typically we don't see any real, we look for these things in standing, and the standing right now doesn't imply that. In fact, with the 17th Amendment, I believe it was, the 17th Amendment, the way that got passed obviously was the normal traditional route through Congress. But
so Congress, three-quarters of Congress, both houses.
Two-thirds of each, both houses passed it.
Two-thirds. Wrote it, passed it, and sent it to the states.
Yeah, and three-quarters ratified it. Uh-huh. But the story of how that came to be is actually one that's through the Article 5 process. This was back when we needed 31 states to get it passed, when that year two new states were being admitted to the Union. And so far, we had 28 states call for an Article 5 convention on the issue of the direct election of senators. And obviously, the reason we had to go for this is because the senators themselves at the federal level don't really want to undo the system of how they got into power and now have direct elections.
Yeah, there's a very large conflict of interest on their part.
Yeah, certainly. And that was coming into play, which is why this process had to be used. And that year, when those two new states were admitted to the unions, there were two other states that had gone on record passing non-binding resolutions saying they were supportive of a convention for this reason, but hadn't filed an actual convention call. And both the two new states that were drafted or that were added to the union said they were going to call for a constitutional convention, and that would meet exactly the 31 state threshold that was needed at the time. So once those two states had come on board saying that they were both going to be supportive of it, all of a sudden, at the federal level, we had action. All of a sudden, the amendment got drafted, got proposed, got passed through both houses. So the standing we see is that with that, the federal government is very aware that if we reach that threshold, they feel as if they're obligated to call. Theoretically, if there was some sort of problem with the independent calls not all being clearly aligned with each other, this seems like the most substantive reason why they could disregard a call. But if they're all very clearly intended for the same purpose and applicable within the same time period, this would probably be something that they couldn't ignore, at least they feel as if. And in fact, there's a Department of Justice report that talks about how the Article 5 process can be called through for a limited convention for such an issue like this. So we see a lot of evidence supporting that should we reach that threshold of 34 states, they would be more obligated to call.
Is there someplace else in the Constitution that talks about constitutional conventions other than Article 5?
Article 5 is pretty much the place that details all of the, at least for our process.
Right, it is interesting that, you know, when our nation was founded under the Constitution, they originally were only going to to tinker with the Confederation, and then the a select group of men went into another room and then wrote the Constitution,
right,
and then presented it to everybody else. And so I think that's why there's no language in the Constitution for a generalized constitutional convention. There's only Article 5.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right, yeah. And, you know, certainly, I mean, we got to pay attention, of course, to our history. And when the reason that was sort of allowed to occur at the time was because we had just had a revolution and the things were, the Union was kind of shaky at the time. Mm-hmm. So when you had all those people who were the ones who went into that room were kind of the general leaders at the time, people who were regarded very highly by the general populace and other people who were in power.
White wealthy people.
Right. Say, right. Certainly. But
males.
They were people who had that sort of authority to do something like that. Uh-huh. If nowadays some select group of people tried to hijack somehow the Article 5 Convention for a process like that, I mean, I don't think the general populace, as much as we talk about voter apathy, I think that would get a lot of people up in arms if you had something even as minor as introducing subjects that were completely unrelated clearly to the intent of the convention calls. I think that would get a lot of people in the streets and very upset.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So there's a number of organizations out there that are working on this question about amending the Constitution. Move to Amend is one, of course, which comes to my mind because at least here in Portland area, I've been heading up that activity. So we're kind of on the same page. We haven't been calling for a constitutional convention. What is your feeling about working with other groups toward this same goal?
Oh yeah, certainly. Wolf-PAC actually in Vermont, where we just recently got our resolution passed through one of the houses, we had an alliance of several groups out there. In New Hampshire, I believe we even had one of our groups that was in an alliance was the NAACP there. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, we certainly are on board to work with as many people as possible. And, you know, the only real difference we have from some of the other groups like Move to Amend is our tactical approach. You know, we're going about this route, but we don't necessarily think that we can't simultaneously work on multiple tactics. So we're very on board with supporting other groups' efforts. We're not trying to bog down any other groups because we're all in this together. We all understand this is the problem. And if we're all attacking at the root of the problem, if we come at it from different angles, that can only be helpful.
Right. Okay, good. And of course, I'm sure you're aware that here in Oregon in the last legislative session, not the long session, we did pass HJM 6, which actually does call for an amendment. Mm. But you're trying to do something different with the legislature. So talk about that just a little bit.
Yeah, so HJM 6 essentially was, we have a nice little phenomenon of similar legislation to HJM 6 occurring throughout the states because everyone knows this is a problem, but no one really, since Article 5 conventions aren't very talked about, like I hadn't really heard of them even though I majored in political science when I was in college. Most people don't really know about them, so it's not a tactic that most, even state legislators, are aware of. So you see a lot of resolutions that just say, hey, they essentially say, you know, this is a problem, Citizens United, we need a constitutional amendment to address that and fix that ruling, because that's clearly not the will of the people. The people clearly disagree. We see polls time and time again, over 90% of the general populace agrees that money in politics is a corrupting problem. Uh-huh. So you see a lot of support from state legislators calling on Congress to take action. But those resolutions don't really have any binding power. The federal government isn't subservient to a state government. So while they say, hey, please, will you pass an amendment? We really need it. We're kind of begging you. They don't have to take action. If we pass an Article 5 convention on this issue, however, we don't need them to then take action following us. Uh-huh. We set the precedent, and that's why we're going through the state governments, because we see they're the ones that pass these things that say we need to have action taken on this issue, and the federal government roundly ignores them. When I'm talking to a lot of representatives and senators, a lot of them are really upset with the reaction to HJM 6 at the federal level, which is essentially to print it off and then throw it in the trash.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So, right. I mean, we're very glad to see resolutions like HJM6 be proposed and be passed, and that's very good, and that gets a lot of people on record saying they're supportive of the issue. But we need to actually take action, if nothing else, to show the federal government that if you don't take action, we're going to. Right. So now's the time to move. Right.
So with 3 minutes left, I know that you have a resolution which you're taking to both Oregon, to Salem, and the organization is taking it to the other states. Mm-hmm. Right. I also know that Move to Mend is working on language for, which would also call for a constitutional convention, but they're doing it through the, potentially doing it through the initiative process.
Yes.
Do you think that you would be supportive of that effort?
Yes, I've actually talked, one of our volunteers is also a volunteer with Move to Mend and has brought this up to me in the past. And you know, since the 2015 legislative session will start in January, I think it would be faster to go through our current route. But if we run into some roadblock once it's proposed and we can't get it passed during the 2015 legislative cycle, I mean, Wolf-PAC, as for all intents and purposes, is focused solely on that intent. But I think you would see me become a volunteer for that movement to make sure that we get it on the petition.
Okay, great. Well, I hope that you're successful in getting it passed through the 2015 legislature. I don't hold out too much hope for that, but it might happen. So in any case, I'll try to support your efforts. And if we have to go the initiative route and get a statewide, the advantage, of course, going the initiative route is that you actually do get a full expression of the people of Oregon, which you don't do by going through the, but you do meet the you know, legal requirement for having a convention.
And really quickly, I just want to also say, those two processes aren't mutually exclusive, which is why I'm very on board for doing both of them. You know, should one of us fail, it would be nice to have a backup strategy, and that's exactly what that is. Right now, I mean, we have Representative Barker, Buckley, Greenlick, Senator Monroe, Senator Edwards, and Senator Monica Anderson have all come on board saying they'd either want to sponsor chiefly or co-sponsor a resolution for the 2015 session.
Excellent.
And I'm still talking with other reps and senators, but that's by no means a guarantee. So I'm certainly glad to see there's other efforts and a backup strategy.
And our viewers who are watching, how could they support you?
If you go to wolf-pac.com, there's one of the links to volunteer. You just put in your information, your email. You'll get you'll get directed to our Google group. We mostly organize through our Google group, and I'll get your email and I'll get in touch with you. Our volunteer coordinator Tony will be in touch with you as well, and we'll get you mobilized. We'll get you trained up and call in those state reps.
Okay, excellent. Thank you so much for being our guest.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you
for
your efforts.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, great. So our guest today has been Colby Clipston. He is the Oregon State Director of Wolf-PAC. Colby and Wolf-PAC advocate for 28th Constitutional Amendment and have an online petition. You sign the petition at wolf-pac.com/petition. I would also suggest that when you do that, you make an additional comment. Colby and I didn't really talk about this, and I intended to, but time ran out. Make this comment. Corporations are not people. They should not have the right to spend money in elections. But we need to be broader than that. We need to be able to control spending in elections, not only by corporations, but by the wealthy as well. The Constitutional Amendment needs to say that that corporations are not people and money is not speech. Populist Dialogues is a project of the Portland Alliance for Democracy. Learn more about us at afd-pdx.org and our national organization at thealliancefordemocracy.org. I want to thank Roger Bates, Melissa Hayes, Brad Leach, Janet Morris, and Tom Thomas for their volunteer time getting us on the air. And I want to thank all of you watching. Thank you. I hope that we'll see you again in 2 weeks. We are going to conclude this program with a video produced by Move to Mend, which, like Wolf-PAC, advocates for 28th Constitutional Convention. Move to Mend advocates for one which clearly eliminates the twin court-created doctrines that money is speech and that corporations are people. The video is titled Legalized Democracy. If you like it, watch the full 30-minute video on YouTube. Just search for Legalized Democracy to view the entire 30-minute video. So with that, we'll watch that, and thank you all for watching.
It is possible to read the history of this country as one long struggle to extend the liberties established in our Constitution to everyone in America. In other words, who, according to our laws and culture, gets to be considered a person? The law creates legal personhood, and movements create law and change culture. So, how have the courts passed laws to shape our culture? That history goes way back before Citizens United. 1819, Dartmouth College versus Woodward, Supreme Court case, turned a corporate charter from a government-granted charter to a contract. This ruling gave corporations standing within the Constitution. 1886, Santa Clara County versus Southern Pacific Railroad. Though the court did not rule on corporate personhood, the decision was subsequently cited as a precedent to hold that a private corporation is entitled to the same 14th Amendment rights of due process and equal protection as human beings. This makes it impossible for us to make laws that treat local businesses any differently than giant multinational corporations, even if their business practices are deemed to be harmful to workers, the environment, and communities, or if they have a history of violating the law. Hale versus Henkel, 1906. The court granted corporations the Fourth Amendment search and seizure protection. Dodge versus Ford Motor Company, 1919. The Michigan Supreme Court says, the business corporation is organized and carried on primarily for the profit of the stockholders. Stockholder primacy is established. The purpose of the corporation, according to the court, is no longer to serve the public good, as it had been. It is now to maximize profit for shareholders above all else. Pennsylvania Coal Company versus Mahon, 1922. Corporations get the Fifth Amendment Takings Clause, meaning, if you pass a regulation that impacts a corporation's ability to make a profit, that is deemed a taking, and they can sue for the right to future profits lost. This creates a chilling effect, and local and state governments become much more hesitant to pass laws in the public interest for fear that corporations can claim loss of potential profits that cities and states will be on the hook to pay. Buckley versus Vallejo, 1976. The Supreme Court rules that spending money to influence elections is protected under the First Amendment, in effect saying that money is speech. Citizens United versus Federal Election Commission, 2010.
Today, the Supreme Court of Chief Justice John Roberts declared that because of the alchemy of its 19th century predecessors in deciding that corporations had all the rights of people, any restrictions on how these corporate beings spend their money on political advertising are unconstitutional.
The court's ruling threatens to undermine the integrity of elected institutions across the nation. It's a rejection of the common sense of the American people.
If you think corporations bought free speech before, now that they're human, they'll buy even more. Yeah, their money has free speech, to me quite a shock.